conference call. Anyhow, I wanted to first let Terry talk, and we have a special guest on tonight, as most of you know. And so, Terry, you can go ahead and go, and then I'll talk afterwards. I think I muted Terry. Hold on.
Am I unmuted?
Terry. Okay, I'm sorry. You were the one that was making noise. I muted somebody. Go ahead.
Oh, I'm the one making noise? Okay. Anyway, I want to welcome everyone to the special guest call tonight. And I know Rodney's spent some time put this together and make it happen. And one of the requests that I have is that we give this guest the courtesy and the respect of anyone that would normally be on a get call. And there'll be no badgering, no hampering, no bashing. And I want to go ahead and leave it to our guest to speak and to Rodney to speak questions. And they'll take it from there how Rodney wants to proceed. So with that, I want to welcome the guest to the call, and I'll turn it over to you, Rodney.
All right. Well, guys, we do have a special guest tonight. He may not feel like the most special person in the world. He seems like a pretty down-to-earth individual. We are going to refer to this individual, which most people may know him on some other blog sites or conference calls, as Contact 2. So before we get started here, the reason of bringing this gentleman on is that he is in the know about a lot of different types of information. And whether after you listen to Contact 2 talk tonight, you may believe what he is saying, you may believe some of what he's saying, you may believe that whatever you want. Again, guys, you know, listening, this is just a conversation. You can take it as you will. It's like a buffet. You take what you want, you leave the rest. The one thing that I do request is I will be the only one asking questions tonight, because that's just how we set up the format of this, and it's not to any disrespect of any of the other GET team managers, administrators, anything of that nature. This gentleman has taken his time to speak with us tonight, and I hope that you guys have brought some pen and paper, because it would probably behoove you maybe to take a few notes. He talks quick, but he will, you know, inform you about quite a few things. And some of this stuff, like I said, may be, I'd probably say most of it is not something, the type of conversation that you've heard in the past. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce you to Contact 2. You there?
Yes, I am. Good evening.
Oh, okay, there you are. Well, again, I appreciate you coming on tonight. We got probably about 1,000 people on the call right now, and they're all ears. So I know we had talked a little bit beforehand of tonight, and so you and I will just have a dialogue back and forth, and I'll just go ahead and let you start. I know that there was one of the things that we had talked about was just kind of giving people an update of sorts and just taking it from there as far as the dinar and all that type of stuff.
Sure, sure. Most of you may know that the Chinese took away the process and the authority of delivering the global settlements and the prosperity packages from the Americans on Friday night, and that's because of the foot dragging. The plan was really to never release this, and that conspiracy has been ongoing for a while. But from Friday night on, there's been a sequence of events, and without getting into a lot of detail, I'll give you the overview. The Chinese usurped the authority to deliver the packages and the prosperity program back to global settlements. From there, they called a series of emergency meetings with the Secretary of Treasury in Washington on Saturday and Sunday. There was a meeting with the dragons in the Pentagon, Chinese dragons. Today, Hillary Clinton recalled virtually all of our ambassadors and yesterday and tomorrow. And the reasons for that is to prevent interference at other levels to continue this process. And in a nutshell, there will be delivery of program packages, the global settlements, after that, and it could be a matter of minutes, it could be a matter of hours. Then there'll be an economic receipt, ER, for Mr. Mike Cottrell, who will be in charge of the refunding of the American dollar, and then to the CMKX folks. And so those things will happen one behind the other very quickly. It could be a matter of minutes, it could be a matter of hours. When that happens, then the new currency, which is the U.S. Treasury dollar, will be distributed. And all indications are that all the banks across the country are now fully loaded with Treasury dollars. With that, immediately after that, then the dinar will revalue. And the dinar was always designed from the beginning of this whole process to revalue into the new currency. So all these things are inextricably linked. One can't go before the other, and they all have to fit neatly together to create a global level playing field economically. And as ironic it is for Americans to believe this, the Chinese have wanted this for a long time. The Chinese funded this operation, and the Chinese are calling the shots on this in spite of the resistance of the American, whether you want to call it the Bush cabal or the dark side or whatever you want to refer to it. They are going to see through this whole process, 140 nations want this done, and the Chinese are the bulldozer making sure that it gets done. So it will happen. If I was fully expecting for deliveries to occur tonight, then they still could tonight, if not tonight, tomorrow, but very soon, within the next day or so. And these sequential things will happen very quick. I believe because of the momentum that these things will be completed by Wednesday night our time, because the Chinese New Year starts on Thursday, which is Wednesday night our time. And I'm certain that the Chinese want to go home after dealing with the Americans to spend their Chinese New Year with their family. Then next Monday, the 7th, the Chinese are going to announce a new banking system. And if I had to guess what they were going to do, we will have a world where everybody will have to exchange dinar to buy oil. Every other trade will be exchanged in a new reserve currency, which will be the Chinese yuan. And so right now, that's what appears to be going down. The rapidity of the actions and the people that are in play strongly suggest that that's how it will go down in that time frame. So that's the overview of where we are. And so the reason I agreed to come on tonight and speak with you all is because the two factions behind this have misled a lot of people about their intentions and how they're going about doing this. A lot of people are under the misconception that the Chinese are a threat. A lot of people are under the misconception that certain American politicians are their friend. And so I'm hoping to give a little clarity tonight on who the players are without having to give you a great big long scorecard. So in a nutshell, that's kind of the overview. So now, Rodney, fire away.
Well, one of the things, I guess, is why is it that the dinar, what is the dinar in all this? That's probably the biggest question that everybody is asking. You know, so how does the dinar tie into this? And I know I've talked about it a little bit in the past. I know we talked about the new currency that's coming out as far as the U.S. Treasury currency versus the old Federal Reserve currency. So I'd probably say that's probably a good place to start and how it ties in.
Well, 19 nations in the Mideast are forming up to have a common currency. This is just one step toward that. The dinar is the beginning. And so they're going to revalue with the dinar out of Iraq because it was kind of set up to do that from the 2003 invasion of Iraq. A lot of dinars were floating around, but there was a lot of debt that the Iraqis were holding and war reparations to Kuwait. So with the dinar devaluing as it is, this gives a perfect scenario for the Kuwaitis to pick up dinar. And then once revalued, they use that revaluing money as reparations without having this be a burden to the Iraqi budget. And the same holds true to the money that the Iraqis owe different European countries. So in one fell swoop, the Iraqi government is flush with cash, and they are, for all practical purposes, debt-free, and their war reparations are paid off, and we have a common trading currency to trade oil. And what most Americans don't realize is if you pull the cost of gasoline around the world, everybody is in the $5.25 to $5.60 a gallon for gasoline. We have been spoiled, albeit cheating the system, by using Federal Reserve notes and printing them to offset our costs for what everyone else is paying for oil. So now, by having to exchange dinar for oil, we'll have to use U.S. dollars to buy dinar, to buy oil, and that'll bring the price of our gasoline up on par with the rest of the world, which will be around $5.25 to $5.50 a gallon. So this is all about leveling the playing field of exchange rates around the world.
So, being that you talked about leveling the playing field, so let's get into the conversation about the central banks. Let's get into the conversation about the Federal Reserve.
Okay.
I know that we've talked about, you know, where the Federal Reserve going away, and so if you want to kind of get into that conversation, how we're leveling the playing field overall just in the banking system.
Well, the Federal Reserve, what's happened is the Federal Reserve has kept the United States government in perpetual debt. And by doing that, it keeps the government subservient and thus the people as slaves, chainless slaves, and what people are referring to as a free society. We are neither free nor are we a republic. The debt level, and you can do this with your own budget, the amount of money that you pay in taxes and that you pay in loans. And you'll be surprised to find out that most of you are seeing 90 to 95% of your income go out the door. That's all created by the Federal Reserve to keep you a slave through debt and taxes. So if the government is debt-free and the people are debt-free, you don't have that control over them anymore. Now, that's been the game that the Federal Reserve has played all along. In order to print money, they basically issue 10 times the face value of the money they print as a debt to the U.S. government. And so it becomes an unending perpetual debt cycle. And there's no way out of it until we take a currency and we base it on metals. And so this transition we're going from, a lot of people have talked about the debt forgiveness. Well, it's just simple mathematics. If your dollar right now, the Federal Reserve note dollar you hold in your pocket is based in debt, it has a negative value. Now the new currency will have a positive value because it's based on something like gold or silver or oil. And so when you add a negative one to a plus one, the result is zero. So there is no way to reconcile the debt from a negative ledger to a positive ledger as the system has evolved over the last 100 years. So we have to revalue all the currencies around the world, and we revalue them against common used and commonly accepted values, which are gold and silver and oil. And so the Federal Reserve doesn't want that. They're fighting that. And the politicians that are fighting that are the ones behind the resistance to get this all done. So it was the Chinese that circumvented all that through various methods and compromising different politicians to get it done. But the end result here is we're going to a currency that's backed by something as opposed by a currency that's backed by nothing, albeit a negative nothing, which is debt. And that's why this is so important. And this is how the Federal Reserve has existed for the last 100 years. It's perpetual debt. And that all ends now.
So if we look at Egypt and Jordan and a lot of these Middle Eastern countries, I know you touched on that with me in a previous call, so we can actually see them as the start of this, as well as we've already seen Greece, many others, so the central banks going on around the world, you know, are they basically in the same boat? these governments?
Yeah, to a degree. What's going on right now is first, in Tunisia and Egypt and in Jordan, you're seeing the Chinese dismember OPEC. OPEC was a creation of Bush and Rockefeller to control the price of oil, a cartel. And so they set up their little despots to do their dirty work in OPEC and to keep everybody else subservient around the world to get oil. I mean, way back when Hitler was running Germany, the reason the Africa Corps was in Africa was to gain control of the oil fields. By controlling the oil, you control the world. Everybody's known that for almost 100 years. So this has been a long-term strategy of a lot of countries. So we had a cartel created called OPEC. It was our invention, American invention. Even though everybody thinks it was Mideast invention, it was not. And so OPEC has controlled the amount of oil going out and the price we pay per barrel. And now you're watching in front of God and everybody the dismemberment of OPEC by the Chinese. Now the situation in Greece is a little bit different. The Greeks knew something that Americans never figured out, and that was Rockefeller had hijacked the Greek banks. And what made the Greeks mad is that Rockefeller had gutted the Greek banks, and so they proceeded to burn all the banks that were owned by Rockefeller companies and their credit reporting agencies. And that's what all the violence in Greece is about, because it upset their entire economy. And that also put pressure on the European Union. And so the French are trying to assuage a lot of this discontent. There's been rumor about Portugal going down and Spain going down and Italy going down and Austria going down. And really those, even though they're in financial difficulties, I don't see them going down. But the evidence of what's going on, what you're seeing happening is, for lack of a better term, the good guys in the world are dismembering the cabals of the world that have been the ruling elite that have kept the whole world under their thumb. And you're watching this happen up close personal in Tunisia and in Egypt and in Jordan. And it's going to spread. We're not done yet. And don't be surprised if the American people find out how their government has been abusing them. Don't be surprised to see the same thing happening here in Washington. When people realize how this has been, the game has been rigged, there's going to be a lot of angry people.
Well, and it's probably good that, you know, maybe you want to touch on that and maybe kind of get some history as far as the way that you have understood it. Because I know that, I mean, just having a conversation with you about a lot of this stuff, it seems so unbelievable. Even the history books that we've been used to, there's probably some validity in some of that stuff. But just like you were talking about the Chinese and, you know, and so forth. So maybe if you kind of went in towards that conversation, gave, you know, the history a little bit different of a history twist, I guess they'd say the truth on some of this.
Sure. Okay, well, let me start with a few premises, okay? I have to go back to when I was in the fifth grade. I had a fifth grade teacher explain to me the reason for education is not to go out there and regurgitate facts and figures and talk back to the teacher and tell the teacher what you want to be heard. The reason for education is like doing calisthenics, being in training to go out and play a sport, whether it's baseball, football, basketball, whatever. So education is the training field to get the mind to learn how to think. We use education now as a process of indoctrination. We're not training the mind how to think. There is no critical thinking going on in our society. What there is a lot of indoctrination. And over the last 50 years, in that indoctrination, we have changed the very meanings of words. We've made the concept of being liberal sound disgusting. And if you go back and you look at the Eisenhower administration, and you look at the things that Eisenhower wanted to do, and he was a Republican. They are no different than now of having a universal health care, having a safety net for people in this country, and people talk about these issues as if they're liberal. They're not. the only reason a government should exist is to do collectively what we cannot do individually. Eisenhower understood that. But over the last 50 years, the very concept right before our very eyes. And in that, we've basically adopted a Pavlovian effect of language. When somebody says the word conspiracy, people automatically think of a crazy, paranoid person. But by making people believe that conspiracy is the outgrowth of craziness and paranoia, then we can hide our actual conspiracies in plain sight. Now that I explained that process and how our education system has evolved into an indoctrination system, now let's talk about what's really been going on. When I was in the United States Army, I was in many countries. One of the last countries I was in Germany. In Germany, I was stationed in a place called Merrill Barracks. You can Google that place. I don't even think Merrill Barracks exists anymore. But Merrill Barracks was actually Südkaserne, and it was on the south side of the city of Nuremberg in Germany, where the war crime trials were held. At Merrill Barracks, Südkaserne, that was the headquarters for the SS. It was four stories above ground. It was four stories below ground. The walls between my room and the next room were 2.5 feet thick of concrete, reinforced concrete, and my door was 1.5 inches thick steel. I could literally take a hand grenade, throw it in the room next door to me, and feel no effects whatsoever in my room. Now that's the way this thing was built. When Patton came in there with the Third Army, he was trying to clear the SS out of there. He went room to room and lost a lot of men trying to clear that room. He cleared the four stories above ground, but left the four stories below ground alone. He wouldn't waste any more men, so he sealed up those floors and flooded them. And those floors remained flooded for years. And in 1974, I was behind our NCO club, and there was a door that went down into those catacombs. I went down there, three stories down, and I found bodies, and I found books, and I found diaries, and the things I read were so insane, I could not believe it. The dirty little secret that I had in the Army is I grew up in a German-American neighborhood. Now, all my friends, their families spoke German, and if I wanted to understand what they were saying, I had to learn German as a child. So I read, and I wrote, and I spoke German, and the Army didn't know that. And so I was reading all these things in those catacombs and realized that these people believed, and the Nazis believed, that they would eventually take over the United States. I read that myself. A few weeks after I discovered this, the chaplain on that same base has found 8mm films behind the chapel. Now, the chapel on that base was actually Hitler's war office. And the red carpet that was over the floor covered a gigantic swastika that covered the entire length and width of the floor. And the altar was Hitler's desk made of white marble, and it was covered with a velvet sheet or whatever. And so the chaplain was showing me around, explaining this, and then showing me these 8mm films that he had found. And so at night, we would lock the door of the chapel, and he would play the film, and I would translate what those films were about. You know, most of this stuff is very horrific, and I don't want to repeat it here because it would serve no purpose. The point of this is I saw firsthand the extreme fanaticism of fascism, what we call Nazis. And it was hard for me to believe that at the end of 1945, they suddenly vanished from the face of the earth. So having seen that kind of fanaticism up close and personal, Americans cannot relate to that. They can't imagine somebody having a 100, 200, 1,000-year plan. We're barely able to keep our focus on a 9-second soundbite. So, what's going on? I put that aside. A couple of weeks of this had gone on, and suddenly the Army military intelligence rolled into that base and discovered, and they cleaned everything out. They took everything. And people that knew what was going on, they suddenly disappeared. Fortunately for me, they didn't know that I spoke German, so nothing was ever said to me. But that stuck in my mind about what we had read there and what I had translated for my buddies and for the chaplain. And it was very unbelievable. And then the next thing that happened from there is a woman I had known that worked for special services, which they provided entertainment and things for the soldiers there, insisted I take a tour to Dachau, which I reluctantly did. And when I got to Dachau, that moment was a life-changing moment. Two things that struck me at Dachau is you could still smell the sweet, pungent odor of burnt flesh, and that's overwhelming. The second thing is it shocks you that they could do this, and the village, which was only a kilometer away, could not know that there was people being burned in this place. And so at the end of the war, Patton ordered the Third Army to take every single villager and march them through that camp because the Germans were in complete denial of what was going on there. And it reminds me very much of Americans today. Americans are in complete denial of what their country has done. And so this is going to be hard for some people to grasp, hard for some people to accept. But the reality is our government was hijacked after World War II by Nazis. I'm not talking about people that want to be Nazis or like Nazis. I'm talking about actual Nazis. The structure of the CIA was patterned after Gehlen's SS, compartmentalized just the same way. And in 1947, when we had the National Security Act, a lot of things were the CIA, NSA, and all these kind of secret agreements that when you work on black projects within the government, you sign away your life. Basically give up all your civilians. And this is all done under the veil of national security. Now, having explained that, the one thing that most people have never heard of is a thing called Project Paperclip. And this was a program after World War II to bring Nazis, what they thought were key Nazis, into our country for their technological expertise. Now, we can account for maybe 3,500 of them, but there were 155,000 of those Nazis on that list. And we don't know where the other 152,000 went. So these are the people, the 152,000 are the ones that infiltrated our intelligence networks. Now, to explain that, there's a book, and you can go find this book. It is called How the Nazis Seized Power. I don't remember the author, but it was originally written as a PhD thesis, and a major German newspaper found out about it. They contacted the doctor who wrote it and then told him to take out the anonymous names, and he used other names for the cities to protect the innocent, all this. And this German newspaper found out about it and asked him to write it with the real names, the real cities in there, about how the Nazis gained power. They wanted to reprint the book, reprint his thesis as a book, so the German people could see how this was done. And the same thing that was done in 1922 to 1939 has been done in our country. In order to gain complete control of this country, you have to first gain control of the intelligence community. You have to gain control of the media. You have to gain control of the banking. And you have to gain control of the military-industrial complex. And once you have those four things, you got complete control. Now, in the process of gaining control of the media, you have to have a willing participant in the religious side of this. In Germany, the fundamentalist Catholics were a big help to the Nazis. In our country, the fundamentalist Christians are a big help to the fascists here. They veil what they're doing through dogma and patriotism so that people will not question the intent. Now, I can say this with some authority because I fell into that same trap, and it's easy to do. Everybody wants to love their country. Everybody wants to think the best of their country. But when you look at the hard evidence, it's hard to ignore. Unfortunately, our country is going to be faced with the same consequences as those villagers in Dachau. At some point, our country is going to get marched through the death camp, and we're going to have to see what we have done. Now, we live in a world right now that has nuclear weapons. And the reason all this is happening with the money right now is way back in the mid-60s, William Casey, along with some people from the Department of Defense, had come to the conclusion that there was no way a nuclear war could evolve on this planet. The Army War College, the Naval War College, the Air War College used all of the computers and gamed out the whole process. All of them came to the same conclusion. There was no happy ending to the nuclear war, no matter who started, no matter who was first strike, or who was retaliating, or who was preempted, just no way around it. So they came up with a plan, and the plan was to undermine the currency of our enemies and make them incapable of waging war. One of the basic principles that they teach in the war colleges is the idea that a strong economy gives you a strong military. Without a strong economy, you have a weak military. And so that concept was played out, and it was brought out, and they discussed it. They wanted to keep it covert, so originally the plan was taken to Howard Hughes. Howard Hughes did not trust the CIA and refused to fund it. That plan stayed shelved until Reagan became president. Then Reagan allowed money to be taken out of the budget and physically, monetarily, gutted the Soviet Union, and they collapsed. All that money that was made in gutting the Soviet currency became basically due to the American people, 43.7 trillion of it. But that was hijacked by Mr. Bush and his cabal, never to be seen again. It was not going to be returned to the American people. Had it been returned to the American people, there wouldn't be the need for global settlements and prosperity programs. All those things were created to hide all this stuff. And so there were two sides of this. There was a good CIA and there was a bad CIA. And these two fought each other. One believed that they were supposed to do the duty of serving the American people, and one group believed they were opportunists, that nobody knew that this money existed, so they were going to use it for their purposes. Now, one of the things the CIA did was use these accounts to launder drug money. And in case you missed the point, the CIA is the organization that runs the drugs around the world. If you have a hard time believing this, I want you to think about this for a moment. Your tax money pays for these satellites that are called Kilo 11, 12, and 12A satellites. They're about the size of a Greyhound bus. They cost about $2.4 to $2.6 billion a piece. I can park one over your house. I can read the date on a dime you lay in your driveway. I can see the ambient temperature of your body in your house. I can listen to your telephone calls. I can read your emails. Now, the only reason that these people get away with this is the American people are ignorant of the technology we possess. We have a constellation of at least 24 of these satellites, and we can park them anywhere in the world we want. I'm sorry. Did you want to say something? Okay. So, the point being, this process of running drugs, if we have those kind of satellites, then how is it we can't find the cocoa plantations and the poppy plantations? If we got that kind of technology, how are drugs produced? You got to have cocoa plants, you've got to have poppies. I find it hard to believe that we can't use those satellites to find them. Well, we don't want to use those satellites to find them. So by taking this equation to where we are today, and we create a system that all the money is backed by hard assets, gold and silver. And we have a method of tracking the money through the Basel III Accord. It will be impossible to launder drug money, and therefore the drug trade will dry up. The covert activities will dry up. You will not be able to fund Al-Qaeda through the Pakistani ISI, which is funded by our CIA. That's the money line to Al-Qaeda. The CIA, to the ISI in Pakistan, to Al-Qaeda. Those things will not be possible. And that's why there's so much resistance about these global funds coming out, these global settlements, these prosperity packages, and revaluing the dinar. Because all those things make the past obsolete. So this is a lot more than just about money.
So basically, that if you even the playing field and you have transparency, then basically you're giving everybody an equal playing, you know.
Right. You're eliminating the reasons for war. You're eliminating the reasons to have a drug trafficking cartel. You're eliminating the reasons to have an oil cartel that manipulates prices. You're eliminating the chainless slave syndrome around the world. I mean, I want, you know, there's things you don't realize that are right in front of you. Henry Kissinger, obviously everybody knows that Henry Kissinger speaks with a very thick German accent. Very few people know that Henry Kissinger was an SS intelligence officer with the Abwehr during the war. But if you look at his official biography, it says he was an Army intelligence officer. And I know for a fact he was an SS officer. And people go, well, gee, he's a Jew. Yes, indeed. Most of the worst SS were Jews. But don't be fooled by the term Jew. The word Jew was not coined until 1036 by John Wycliffe. Okay, it was a misnomer of Judah, the area in the Middle East. There was no sect or no Jewish religion. There was a Christian sect. But this was all reinvented by the religious people around the world to gain control of people's minds. Now, people go, well, that's impossible. Well, yeah. Well, what is Catholicism? It's universalism. And where did that come from? It came from Emperor Constantine. And why did he do that? Because the Roman Empire was collapsing because of the rebellion between the pagans and the Christians. And so he took pagan rituals and he gave them Christian names and saved the Roman Empire. That cross on your churches is not a cross. When people were crucified, they were not crucified on a cross. It was an economy of effort. They didn't build a cross and then staple people to it. What they did is they put their wrists together and put one big spike through them and hanged them from a tree like that or a post. They didn't build a cross. That cross is actually a T for the pagan god Tanis. And this is how religion is used to control people's minds. And the fascists love that. The fascists are interwoven with their mysticism in a system of gaining people's mind through their belief structures. It's the oldest trick in the book. I'm not saying there isn't a God. Yeah, I believe in God. I don't want to go off in that tangent. But what I'm trying to explain is religion has been a tool for the fascists for centuries. This is not new. And so by combining religion and patriotism together, you create a very powerful, extremely powerful mindset that you can get people to go off and do the most horrendous things in the name of God and country. And that's how fascism works. That's why the Nazis were so fanatical.
Right. Well, Let's switch directions a little bit. What about getting back to, say, China? I know that you had mentioned to me about the gold exchange between the U.S. and China. Maybe that might help you maybe enlighten people a little bit about some of these things.
Sure.
Because one of the things people are always going to ask is that, you know, where's the facts? Where's the evidence? I mean, this is your personal opinion. I mean, I guarantee if somebody probably had blasphemy in their head or shouting it out in just the past 30 seconds just because of what you said, because you know how you're going to tug on a lot of emotional strings talking about somebody's faith or religion. I don't see that you're taking away anything from God or Jesus or the Bible or anything of that nature. What you're trying to do is put into context how a manipulation is done, whether it's marketing tools or any number of different things. But I think this... This conversation with you told me about between China and the United States with the gold, I think that may be surprising to a lot of people.
Sure. Let me go back for a second, and I apologize to anyone I may have offended, and it has nothing to do with faith of real people or real belief. It has everything to do with politicians that manipulate those beliefs. I want to be clear about that. I'm not taking away from anybody's personal beliefs. I believe all religions have merit. Now, getting into the Chinese, Chinese have been around for a long time, and they have far exceeded the technology that we had. So I'm going to go back a little bit so that you can get a perspective of what the Chinese are all about. A lot of Americans are paranoid of the Chinese. Indeed, my first encounter with that kind of paranoia was when I debated a U.S. congressman about the need to create the B-2. The career I had put me in a situation where I was involved with a lot of high-tech weaponry testing, and before the B-2 even rolled off the assembly line, it was obsolete. But the reason it got funded is some congressmen were convincing people that we needed the B-2 because of the fear of the Chinese. The Chinese have no expansionist intention. First, if you look at what the Chinese have done, 200 years before Christ, they created paper, they created printing, they created gunpowder, and they created the compass. And with the compass, they explored the entire world, and they mapped the entire world. And I defy you to find a Chinese colony anywhere in the world. They didn't colonize like the Europeans did. There's no Chinese colony in South America. There's no Chinese colony in Africa. There's no Chinese colony in North America. That was never their intention. That's not in their psyche. That's only in the Anglo-Western European psyche. So they don't pose a threat as expansionists. Now, they have evolved to, one more point. I think this is fascinating. To me, this is very fascinating. About 1,000 years before Galileo existed, there was a Chinese scientist, I believe his name was Zhao Fang, and he built a 6-story astrolabe. And this was like a very precise clock. And on the top of this astrolabe was a telescope. And at any time in the year, he could go up into this astrolabe and pinpoint any planet or any star. They had already mapped the heavens thousands of years before we even crossed, before Anglos from the west of Europe came to North America. They had such incredible technology. 100 years after Christ was born, they had already had blast furnaces creating cast iron and steel. They were actually making steel. They built 200-pound bombs, cast iron bombs, that were as powerful as the bombs that we dropped from B-17s over Germany during World War II. Very few people realized they had this kind of technology. And you would think with that kind of technology that they would have conquered the world, but they didn't do that. And so we rely on our ignorance to create a paranoia about the Chinese that doesn't exist. Now, let's fast forward to where we are today. In 1933, during the Great Depression, China had a little problem. They had dissension in their country. So the United States and China could mutually help each other. We needed to restart our economy. The Chinese had a ton of gold that they didn't want it to fall in the wrong hands. There was an internal struggle behind Chiang Kai-shek and the rebellion that Mao Zedong had led. Now, there was some assistance by the Chinese elders. They wanted to use Mao Zedong and communism to unite China, because up until that time, China was very fragmented. So the Chinese were very pragmatic. They used communism as a tool. We think of communism as something horrible. The problem is that there is no absolutes in political theory. There is no absolute socialism. There is no absolute democracy. There is no absolute capitalism. There is no absolute communism. There is no absolute anything. But we think in terms of absolutes when we want to demonize things we don't understand. So the Chinese elders wanted to unite their country. They had a problem. The United States had a problem. So in 1933, the Chinese said, look, we'll lend you the equivalent of $43 trillion to restart your economy. So they spirited the gold to the Philippines and then across into Mexico and then back up into the United States. And that $43 trillion was parked in the Federal Reserve banks and used to issue money to restart our economy in the Depression. Now, they lent us that money on a 75-year lease. So from 1933 to 2008 was 75 years. But at the time, everybody inside the government, the U.S. government, knew about this and didn't want to talk about it. Then along comes George Bush Sr. He becomes President of the United States, and when he starts giving the speeches about the New World Order and 1,000 points of light, and if you go back, there's a speech that Hitler made almost identical to that in Nuremberg in 1941. And it was the same thing, a New World Order, 1,000 points of light. When I heard George Bush give that speech during his reign in 92 to 96, it was chilling to hear those words come out of his mouth, because I had just read those when I was in the service in Germany. Now, the reason he was so arrogant about even saying those words is he believed that the last of the Chinese dynasty family had passed away, and that he would not have to pay back the gold that we borrowed from the Chinese to restart our economy. So his intention was to steal that gold. This goes on until Clinton becomes president, and one day they discover that there's an heir to the Chinese family in Taiwan, and they're going to have to pay that gold back. Now the wheels start going into motion. Around 1999, early part of 99, there was a company called Heavylift out of England, and they had leased one of two Antonov 225 Russian aircraft, and that airplane was spirited away at a little place called Stewart Airfield, and it was 50 miles north of New York City up the Hudson River. And what they started doing in 99 is every Friday night, four garbage trucks would go into the bottom. What? I'm sorry. Every Friday night, four garbage trucks would go into the bottom of the World Trade Center, and four pallets of gold that belong to the Chinese are loaded on those garbage trucks. They go two blocks down to the pier, get on a garbage scow. By this time, it's 11 o'clock at night, and the garbage scow goes out into the darkness, and most people think they're going to go out to the ocean and dump the garbage. But they turn around, they go up the Hudson River 50 miles to Lawrenceville, New York, and they get off there, and they drive 2 miles over Stewart, and they load the gold on this Antonov 225. The Antonov 225 is a very easy plane to find. There's only two of them ever built. One remained in Russia, and the other one was leased by this British freight company called Heavylift. The airplanes on Saturday night would take off under the cover of darkness, go out over the ocean, and then pretend that they were coming from Kiev in the Ukraine across nonstop to Mojave, California. And they would call the air traffic controllers, and we don't have any radar out over the ocean, so there was no way to verify that the airplane actually flew across the ocean. And no controller would ever look at that flight plan and figure out that the airplane didn't have that kind of range. Anyway, the point is, the airplane would land in Mojave Saturday night, 9:30, every Saturday night, and offload the 64 tons of gold. And then the gold would be hidden in the ammo bunkers of Mojave Airfield, because it used to be a Marine Corps Air Station during World War II. And this went on for 99 to 2000, and taking the gold out of the bottom of the World Trade Center. Then, when the thing was empty, it was time to pull the plug. So, in order to hide the evidence that they stole all this gold, they imploded Tower 1 and Tower 2. And they threw in Tower 7 as an added bonus, so that the CIA records and Treasury records that were there were destroyed. Now, there was a lot of things behind 9/11 that make it impossible. The first thing you have to realize is that if you believe the story that a bunch of guys with box cutters are going to attack the cockpit, maybe there's something you don't know about what's in that cockpit. Behind every airliner, behind the seat of the captain, is a fire axe. And believe me, if the captain comes out of that cockpit door with a fire axe, a guy with a box cutter doesn't have much of a chance. So the story about a bunch of guys taking over the airplane with a box cutter is fantasy on the face of it. Second thing is, you cannot make a cell phone call from an airplane. If you're below 8,000 feet, doing under 200 knots, maybe. But if you're above 8,000 feet and you're doing 455 knots, you're not getting a cell reception at all. You can't do it to this day unless they have a cell repeater on the aircraft itself, which didn't exist back then. So there were three airplanes. The fourth one was actually a drone. launched from an abandoned field in West Virginia, and that's what hit the Pentagon. The light standards on the street are 90 feet apart. A 757 has a 175-foot wingspan. If you look at that Pentagon photo of that white thing that hit it, it went between the light stands. So whatever it was less than 90 feet across. It wasn't 175 feet across of a Boeing 757. Now here's the big, dirty... So these are tough questions you got to ask yourself. I had access to the air traffic control tapes before they were destroyed. I had access to the radar data recording of where those airplanes turned around and how they evaded air traffic control. And I have worked with NORAD many times. And the story of them not being able to intercept these airliners for 2.5 hours is pure nonsense. I have intercepted Russian bear bombers off the coast of California in less than 7 minutes. So I don't believe it takes them 2.5 hours to find an airliner. And that's the facts. You can Google that all you want. There's a physicist at the University of Utah that found that there was an explosive found in the dust called nanothermite. Nanothermite is an explosive that can be painted on the concrete, and then it vaporizes the concrete when it's detonated. There's only one place nanothermite was made at that time, and it was in Israel. Now, these are the facts. You can go out and Google them all you want. Now, there's nothing new with this, because the Germans did the same thing in 1939 to the German people. It was called Gleibitz. You can Google that. That's G-L-E-I-W-I-T-Z, Gleibitz, Germany. And what the Germans did is a very similar scheme. They took German soldiers, and they dressed them up as Polish guerrillas, and then they took Polish prisoners and dressed them up as German soldiers. And miraculously, they didn't have handheld video cameras back then. Miraculously, there happened to be an 8mm camera there when these alleged Polish guerrillas came in and killed all these German soldiers. And then they took over the Gleibitz radio station and broadcast to all of Germany that they were going to bring down Hitler. So all of Germany heard on the radio that the Polish guerrillas had attacked their country. And miraculously, that film of those German guerrillas attacking German, or those Polish guerrillas attacking those German soldiers, played in every movie house in Germany. And 4 months later, there wasn't a single German who said, no, we won't attack German, or attack Poland. And on September 1st, 1939, the Germans attacked Poland with a vengeance because they believed the story. And that's what happened on 9/11. They created this whole thing. Bush and Clinton financed Al-Qaeda. But those guys were not even on the airplane. If you look at the video, the security camera from the airport, I think it was in New Hampshire, that these guys supposedly got on. If you notice, take a look at that video. Somebody blurred out the timestamp and the date stamp on that video. Now, why would they do that? Why would they destroy all the air traffic control tapes and the 3 black boxes that were found on the street in New York City? Why were they spirited away by the FBI? A black box can take an impact of 2,500 G's. That impact was less than 25 G's. Those black boxes were intact. But if somebody had opened those black boxes and listened to the recordings, what they would have found is somebody had taken over the aircraft from the ground. Oh yeah, how did they do that? Well, you go back to the 60s and 70s where I cut my teeth in aviation. There was tons and tons of hijackings and bomb threats. And somebody over at DARPA, the Defense Advanced Research Projects Administration, came up with a genius idea. In the flight management computer of an airliner, we would embed a secret piece of software called Home Run. That was a code name for it, Home Run. And Home Run was designed for us to take over the airplane from the ground using normal VHF frequencies. So if they were hijacked or the crew was disabled, we could land the airplane safely without the entire passengers, the entire cargo passengers being killed. We had that capability. Every Boeing 757 and every Boeing 767 that rolled off the assembly line had that software in it. That's why those two aircraft were used. That's how it was done. Once you use Home Run, you control everything. You control the door locks. You control the radios. You control the navigation. You control the lights. You control everything on the airplane like you're on board from the cockpit. But you're actually remotely doing it. Specifically, that's what I worked on. It was remotely piloted vehicles. And the reason I know about that is one of the technicians that worked at DARPA worked with me for 3 years. And I knew all about it. Now, that's the technology we have that you didn't know about that made that possible. Those airplanes were remotely controlled, and then the intelligence agencies concoct all these other conspiracy theories and put them on the Internet to hide the real problem, the real story. They created one where they touched up the video and put what looks like it'd be a bomb or a rocket under a 767. They make a little white flash and make it look like it was an explosion when it hit the World Trade Center. They put out probably 8 or 9 different conspiracy theories to hide the real one. Up until now, you've probably never heard of Home Run or that it existed for the last 30 years.
Now, tying this all back together, because again, I know that you've said in a lot of stuff, whether people believe it or not, but tying this all back together, how does this, you know, how does this all come together? So I know there's probably some people that got on the call late, which, you know, that's, they'll have to listen to the call again. But, you know, I guess looking at all this, how does it all tie together? Where we're at today, you know.
Okay. All right. Well, the keep in mind, the whole reason for that issue of 9/11 was to hide the theft of $43 trillion in gold. Also, that part of that is real assets. But this has been going on in different fashions, from the savings and loan scandal that was orchestrated and run by Neil Bush to the modern-day banking scandals and the mortgage problems of today. This is all done with fiat currency, creating artificial wealth. As they do this, the people that actually are working for a living are becoming more and more as slaves. More and more of their sweat is being used to create wealth for these people. And so they're able to launder this money overseas in all kinds of accounts. And so in order to stop that, we have to have first a currency that's backed by something that it cannot be counterfeited. So that's gold and silver. Second, we have to have a international regulatory agency that allows for the supervision of bank accounts, which is what Basel II and Basel III do. And so all these things occurring at the same time make it impossible for these bad people to continue financing their operation, because the whole thing now becomes transparent. It's not transparent now. And all these things I'm telling you about, they've done in the past, they will not be capable of doing in the future. So we're not just talking about money. We're talking about transparency of banking. We're talking about unified laws. We're talking about a level playing field of value of currencies. I mean, somebody had mentioned that, oh, they thought this was going to lead to a global currency. It will not. Currencies are designed to be sovereign instruments, like a public utility. And therefore, the reason we're going through all this revaluing and rebalancing is so all countries can have their own currencies if they choose to, but those values will be set that it will be a reasonable expectation of what you'll get in return for it tomorrow. And by doing the Basel II and Basel III requirements, and by creating a currency that's backed by assets, we eliminate the ability to create wealth out of nothing. We eliminate the ability to create debt out of nothing. We eliminate the ability of people to manipulate markets for their own self-interest. If you're in the American stock market now, you're going to lose your butt very soon, because this market is highly manipulated. And the only people that are in it right now are going to be left holding the bag. And that's retirement fund and mutual fund managers. And these kids, you know, they're in their mid-30s. They've never seen a recession before. They've never seen a depression before. And all these MBAs have don't mean a hill of beans, because they don't understand the root of where money came from. The Chinese had printed money over 2,200 years ago. And the reason they had printed money is so it was easy for their tax collectors to collect their tax. They couldn't carry around pounds, you know, 100 pounds, 200 pounds of gold. So they created paper money to have the ability to collect taxes more efficiently. That's the original reason paper money came about. It wasn't designed to create wealth out of nothing. And so where we are today, this revaluing the dinar and the payment of the settlements and the prosperity packages is to put a whole new currency out on the street to level the playing field for everyone. And so if you have a legitimate business and you have a legitimate bank account and you can prove where your money came from, the money you have in the bank right now, when this is over, will just convert over to the new treasury dollar. There won't be anything more difficult than that. But if you have money overseas and you can't prove the origins of it, then that money is worthless. In order to make this all happen, we have to go through the process that you're seeing unfold right now.
So we've heard things about the Amero. You know, is there any validity to that? Of course, you've already touched on the new U.S. Treasury bills versus the old Federal Reserve bills, but is there any validity to the Amero?
Well, yeah, the Amero was concocted by the Bush-Clinton cabal, and it was basically to perpetuate the system we already had in place. But the trick to the Amero was we're running huge deficits. Okay, the peso and the Canadian dollar are much stronger currencies than the U.S. dollar, and I can almost guarantee you there isn't a Canadian in the world that wants to jump on board and finance the American debt. Likewise for the Mexicans. So this was a way of diluting our debt across two other countries.
Go ahead.
No, I just said that wouldn't fly. That's the reason the Amero came out. People heard about it, but it's not going to be a reality.
So when this thing is all said and done, again, because it's so hard to fathom for people, and I know even sometimes it's hard for me to wrap my head around it. So you have, you suddenly have all the debts are paid. So, and then not only that, but is there really enough to go around, or are they just going to, you know, basically do a do-over, a reboot? You know, how are all these debts going to be paid? Are all these debts going to be paid? Is it just the United States? Is it the United States that has basically been screwing everybody over in, you know, these global settlements? Is it just with them? Is there any sort of clarity that you can give us, some color on that?
We go back to the first comment I made about that, is our dollar is created out of debt. So that's a negative value. And so when we're having a new currency, a treasury dollar, actually got a positive value based on gold and silver, they would essentially cancel themselves out mathematically. The problem is if we have to reconcile things from, like, let's say we convert tomorrow, if we have to reconcile previous debts based in a negative and we're reconciling them to a positive, that's mathematically impossible. So the only solution is to zero them out. But the majority of the debt we're carrying are collateralized debt obligations. And here's the trick to this thing. Most of the big banks that are upside down, that are struggling, they are carrying tons and tons of CDOs, collateralized debt obligations, and the same across the world. Bernanke, under pressure about 3 weeks ago, admitted the CDOs were worthless. So effectively, he's already admitted that all the debts are gone. Now, the CDOs are based on the mortgages that were packaged in this mortgage kiting scheme that you look at as the mortgage debacle. Right now, any mortgage that was written since about 2003 is probably worthless, because in order to sell these CDOs, they had to pull off the promissory note so that the investors overseas could not see if these notes were performing or non-performing, and that would be based on the amount of money they would pay for that mortgage-backed portfolio they would buy as an investment vehicle. Now, what's happened, the scheme was this. A spinoff of Delmarva, which was a CIA front operation, was a company that still exists and still in its operation in Pinellas, Florida, called Nationwide Trust Services. And Nationwide has people down there, some of them can't even speak English,
But they're listed as a vice president for documents for Wells Fargo, or vice president so-and-so for Bank of America. Anyway, they got all these people at the Nationwide Trust Services there in Pinellas, Florida, that have never been to a Bank of America office, never been to a Wells Fargo, never been to a Deutsche Bank office, and they're signing these documents, rolling these mortgages over. And this is a spinoff into MERS. Some of you have heard about MERS. And all of this is fraudulent. So when this money is reissued, the new currency, they cannot prove at this point that there is a mortgage obligation because there's no promissory notes. Because they destroyed them in the process, so they couldn't prove, they didn't have any way to prove that the mortgages were performing or not performing. They did this to deceive the investors. Now it's turned around and bit them in the butt, because now, if you can't prove that there's a promissory note attached to that mortgage, by rule of law, your house is free and clear. Now, if this becomes known publicly to the entire country, and it's already been proven in a Massachusetts case, it's already been proven in an Ohio case, you don't have the promissory note back into the mortgage, therefore your house is free and clear. So that's another avenue by which debts are going to be forgiven. Because when this is all over, the CDOs have been forgiven bank to bank, and the things that are undermining or underlying those CDO values are the mortgages. And the mortgages have no promissory notes. So, essentially, everybody is debt-free.
Now, so are you saying that individually, the way that they've been doing this, as far as the mortgages that people, I mean, of course, we all know about the mortgage bubble burst here in the past couple years, and believe me, I was selling mortgages myself through a company. So you're saying that, for the most part, that a lot of these mortgage debts that people have are going to basically be gone, or, you know, this is kind of making a lot to swallow.
Yep, they're going to be gone. Because you can go, you can walk in any court of law and say, hey, Mr. Bank of America, show me the promissory note. And if they can't show a promissory note, there's no mortgage. And if there's no mortgage, you own the house free and clear. Okay. We have rules for transfer of property value in this country. And you have to prove that. Now, I want to interject something. MERS has also played a game. Because of our archaic ways of recording property, they found a little loophole, and I'm going to warn everybody about this. When you go out, after this is all over, and the money's refunded or revalued, and the new currency's out there, I want to warn you about something that the bad guy's going to do. A lot of people, when I have a group of people that I talk to, and I had advised them, you know, when this is all done, go out and buy hard assets, income-producing real estate, gold, silver, those kinds of things, but mainly things that are hard assets that produce cash flow. But the caveat to this is very simple. MERS has been running around the country and placing liens on property that there's no way to prove that the lien was not valid or not. So they tie you up in court and they foreclose before you even know it, and they're basically stealing your property because of a hole in our way of tracking real estate. So what I'm going to suggest to everyone listening is when you buy a piece of real estate and you are in escrow, you go and you get yourself a private real estate attorney. And you have that real estate attorney go to the courthouse and get a certified copy of the deed for that property. So it shows the liens on that property. You get that in your hot little hand, certified by the courthouse. And while you're in escrow, you have those lien holders satisfied out of escrow. And you have them submit you a letter that their lien on the property is satisfied. Now, if MERS comes along later and says, well, we were subject to that property on this other lien or whatever, and they say they're putting a lien on your property, you can, it's a rule of estoppel. You stop them right there, because our courts in this country cannot commit fraud. And so if they give you a certified copy of the trust or the deed of the property, and it's got the only lien holders there, nobody can come along later and say that the title company was defrauded or the title insurance company defrauded. No, they can say that. They can get away with that. But nowhere in our rule of law do courts commit fraud. So if you got a certified title from the courthouse, it stops people like MERS from putting a lien on property after it's free and clear. Now, they've done this on four occasions that I know of, gotten away with it because people couldn't prove that there wasn't a lien. They didn't have the wherewithal. They didn't understand how this game was being played. So when this is all over and you buy real estate, while you're in escrow, you go get your own real estate lawyer, and you have them pull a certified copy of title from the courthouse. And that way, if anybody ever claims after the fact to have a lien on property, you can stop them right there. Say, I got a certified copy from the courthouse, and you have no claim. And they have no way of fighting you on that because our courts do not commit fraud.
Now, a lot of people who are listening to this call are dinar holders for the IQB. You know, one of the screwiest things that we can ever seem to put our finger on, and I know that you're not a professional in this, and you may not even know the answer to this question, but you seem to have quite a bit of knowledge in a lot of areas. But everybody's worried about the taxes, or probably better said is that we don't know what the tax implications are going to be in cashing out this currency, or basically swapping one currency for another. Have you heard anything? Have you talked to anybody? Have you talked to a professional? Do you have any, I guess you'd say, advice on, I know, going and getting a tax attorney or a professional of that nature to handle these affairs, but I know many times that we've even contacted the IRS themselves, and we've gotten five or six different answers, you know, from them, so they don't even truly know.
Yeah, well, the IRS will confuse a lot. There are three avenues of thought, and you have to be patient with the timing on this, and there's a couple of reasons here. You want to be slow to cash out the dinar, and here's a couple of reasons. And first, I want to put up front that I'm not a financial advisor, but just looking into the situation here, to be cautious is to be slow in cashing these out, and the reasons why. If you take it as just a straight capital gain, if you go cash them out right up front, most likely you're going to get hit with a 35% tax capital gain. If you wait a year and a day, you're probably going to get long-term capital gains of about 15%. Now, that's assuming the IRS is still in place. But with the new currency and the government being debt-free and the people being debt-free, I don't believe the IRS is going to be in the same game any longer. And they may not even come in. So those are the three schools of thought you should consider. And some people have talked about a base rate. I don't know. I'll tell you a little story about that. And if there's any IRS agents listening, I'm past the statute of limitations. So I'll take you back to 1973 for a moment. When the U.S. went off the gold standard in 1971, they started floating the U.S. dollar against the Deutschmark. And they did this so that Boeing and a lot of other people could sell a lot of heavy equipment to the Germans. Where I was right there in Nuremberg, right there on the base, was an American Express bank that had the contract from the Department of Defense to provide banking for the GIs on there. The interesting thing about the American Express is if I took American dollars, which I got my pay as a soldier, and I went into American Express and converted to Deutschmark, I would get a 3.5% discount on my Deutschmark. And then if I walked off the base three blocks down the street and went to the bank, I would get a 3.5% to 4% discount on dollars. So I would take $1,500 and I would go get Deutschmark, and I would walk downtown, I'd take that and I'd go buy dollars, and I come back with about 1,600. And then I go back and I get more than which mark, and then I would come back and I have about 1,800. And I can do this 3 or 4 times a day. So I don't want to go into how much I made, but I made a lot of money doing that over a course of about, maybe a month, month and a half. And so we had a, I don't know if he was a real IRS agent or just somebody for the Army that would advise soldiers on how to fill out their taxes. When I explained this to him, he said, I don't know how you would base that because you're exchanging currency. I don't know what your base would be, what your base value would be on that. So this guy just said, I don't know what you would report, so I guess it's not income. Now, that's changed a lot. So I kind of walked in 1973 and made a lot of money just by exchanging currency. That might be what happens this time. And I'm saying might be, but I would exercise a great amount of caution as this thing goes forward. And assume at the beginning you're going to pay a short-term capital gain of 35% based on the net value you cash out for against what you actually pay for the dinar. And that's right. The safest way you can do it.
Right. Yeah, and most of us are, we're not trying to get one over on the IRS. We've always instructed people to do the right thing, and we knew about the 35 to 15% depending on when you purchased it and how long that you, of course, have had that. The next question that really pops up for me, and again, it's something that people, again, just it's hard for them to wrap their heads around, is that, we're saying that there's going to be a new currency, which means that the Federal Reserve is going to be non-existent, which means the IRS is pretty much going to gradually fade away into the sunset. We hear things where there's going to be a lot of people who are going to be tried for possible treason to, and not just here in the United States, but, around the world for, supporting this entire crazy mechanism of what the central bank has been doing and so forth. But how can you actually, because I remember when a gentleman brought this to me, I'm sitting there thinking, like, how are they going to suddenly get rid of, throw the people in the blah, 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 so forth and so on. How are they going to pull this all off? I mean, there's got to be a huge game plan put in this. How are you going to do this without disrupting the people? I mean, it's hard enough for people to fathom, who killed JFK, let alone, all the crazy that could possibly come out of all the dirty secrets or any number of things. How do you keep all that wrapped up? How do you go forward and change something so drastic that we've been so used to for so long and suddenly switch gears and go into something else without everybody finding out about it, without the the United States having, I know that you're going to have all these debts and so forth, but I guess what I'm trying to say is how can we all be able to wrap our heads and think logically about this for a moment? And if there's no way possible, I totally understand, but there's got to be a plan put in place.
Well, sure there is, and I have to take you back to Dachau. We're going to have our march through the Dachau concentration camp, but it's going to be the whole country. And one example that I know firsthand was the March 2003 bombardment of Baghdad. While everyone watching the shock and awe, we were dumping 12,840 cruise missiles on Baghdad. And these were not the neat ones you see on TV that go through the window or down the chimney. These were first generation cruise missiles that weren't exactly that good. 80 defense intelligence analysts estimate that 80% of those missiles did not hit their targets. And they went into shopping centers, and they went into schools and mosques and residential areas. I actually did see the satellite BVA photos of thousands of Iraqi innocent civilians who were killed that day while everybody else was watching our troops with Tommy Franks who were running up the highway there to Baghdad. On that day, we killed over 220,000 Iraqi civilians and maimed another 610,000. And the websites have been blocked here, but I think if you go to Doctors Without Borders, there may still be some photographs of 2 and 3 year old Iraqi children with no arms and legs. And I'm not talking about some missing some legs, some missing. I'm talking missing all 4 appendages. And that's a war crime, and we did that. And so that's our Dachau moment. Then you have Dick Cheney openly says on television, yeah, he authorized torture, a violation of the Geneva and Hague Convention. He openly says it, and it's like, so what? Well, by his own admission, he's a war criminal. So we're going to see these things come out. There will be tribunals, and the tribunals will either be done by us or they'll be administered by an international tribunal made up of, you know, probably a composite of whoever the 140 nations decide they want to send. But there will be a day of reckoning. That much I guarantee you. And the American people are going to choke on this because they're going to have their Dachau moment. They're going to get marched through the concentration camp, and they're going to see all the things that have been done that they thought were funny. You know, I remember if we go back to when Carter was president, we had the issue with our hostages in Tehran, and people were running around, you know, nuke the Iranians, nuke the Iranians, nuke the Iranians, and we were all supporting the Shah and all this stuff. Well, people never looked really hard at the Shah. This was a guy that was so despicable that he murdered his own father to become an American puppet to take over Iran. Now, think about that. Who among you would kill your own father for money? Now, that's the kind of people that our government, who claims to be a democratic and freedom-loving nation, supports. These are the realities of history you have to look at. These are things that you can check. These are things you can Google. These are things you can do your own research on. And they've been in front of you all of your life.
So, now we mentioned about China before, how they basically were the ones that were pushing all of this. As far as they are... that have happened, China basically has their thumb to be able to push the people, I guess you said, the dark side of the force, out and force them to basically give up their power to allow, you know, things to get back to some equality, you know, an equal playing field. But at the same time, you also have other countries. It's not just China. And I just want you to kind of elaborate a little bit more on that because, you know, people are going to see, well, China's taking over all these banks. They're coming into America. They want to take over this. You know, what's going on with the banking system? How can they shut these, you know, these banks down, you know, because they're not certified, whatever, so forth and so on. So if you can give any sort of, you know, color on that, that would be great.
Yeah, okay. Well, let's give a little perspective. You know, first, right now, out of the Mideast, out of the 10 tankers, oil tankers that leave the Mideast, one will go west to the United States and 9 will go east to China. China's importing a huge amount of oil, and it is in their best interest to stabilize the Mideast and to get rid of the OPEC cabal created by Bush and Rockefeller. And they level the playing field not just for themselves, but for the entire world. And we have to keep this in perspective of why they're doing this. These people in China, the elders, the people that are behind the scenes that are the kingmakers, these people are not, they're politicians. These people are not in the Communist Party. They use the communist concept to unify China into a very strong nation. Right now, China has a much higher literacy rate than children in the United States do. Right now, China has the fastest high-speed rail in the world. They're building infrastructure at an alarming rate. We have economists in this country that mock China when they say they're increasing their GDP by 9 to 13% a year, and we go, you can't possibly do that. That's impossible. Well, I want you to imagine the infrastructure that the United States had in 1905, and imagine if that was the infrastructure we have at this moment, and we had 3 times our population, and we were going to build out that infrastructure today based on what we had in 1905. That would be a huge, huge undertaking. And of course our GDP would explode at 9 to 13%, maybe 15% a year. And so that's what the Chinese are doing. They're not looking to expand. They're looking to enhance what they already have. And so to do that, they have to pull in an enormous amount of resources from Brazil and South America and from Southeast Asia and from India and from Europe and the Mideast and from Africa. And they are very, very pragmatic. They give to get. They understand that there has to be a symbiotic relationship. And we don't understand that. We don't believe in a game of where there's two winners. There's a winner and a loser in our thinking. In the Chinese thinking, there's a winner and a winner. That gives them long-term sustainability. We don't think in that terms. And so that is our downfall of understanding what they're doing. Now, I'm not saying they're altruistic. I'm saying they're very pragmatic. And they're pragmatic in this way. They are very powerful, and they're gaining more power each day by focusing on making their lives better. The Chinese elders do not want their grandchildren or their grandchildren's children to live under the threat of a nuclear holocaust. So in order to take that away for the betterment of the entire civilization, they've learned how to economically get what they want without firing a shot. You know, and the Western civilization really struggles with understanding this, really has a problem with this, because we don't think that way. We want it now. Immediate gratification isn't fast enough. The Chinese will take their time, and they will build out what they have to build out to get to where they want to go. If it takes them 5 years or 50 years, they're going to do it methodical for a better way of life later. We want it right now. And that's the difference in the philosophy. So when they're dealing with other countries, they're going to be very pragmatic. They don't need the military. Let me tell you a little story that very few people understand. They saw it, but didn't know what happened. The Chinese, like a bunch of boneheads, we parked two nuclear carriers off the coast of China. Now, everybody's heard about the 3-mile limit, and most people don't understand where the 3-mile limit came from, or the 12-mile limit, or 200-mile limit, okay? Internationally, the 3-mile limit was established centuries ago because that's as far as a cannon could shoot. That was a cannon shot 3 miles offshore, so that was the international limit. Then when the airplanes came along, we created economic zones. And those went out to, I think, 50 or 100 miles. And now that we have more powerful weapons, the United States unilaterally created what was called an exclusive economic zone, which is essentially a 200-mile limit around us. Now, we get all upset when somebody goes into our exclusive economic zone, which is basically our international line. But when other countries exercise that exclusive economic zone, we don't acknowledge that. So what we did a few months back is we parked two nuclear carriers inside of China's exclusive economic zone. And they politely asked us to leave. And we would not leave. So while they are thinking they've got China over the barrel, one of China's submarines quietly pulled up 35 miles south of San Diego and fired an imp weapon at the USS Ronald Reagan, and it exploded behind the Reagan. Now, the Reagan is hardened. The input was affected, but it fried all the electrical equipment on the Princess cruise boat that had to be towed into San Diego, for those of you who remember that. And basically what they were telling the Americans is, we could take in your aircraft carrier out anytime we wanted. So if you want to play this game with us, we'll play it with you. And that Chinese submarine sat right at the mouth of San Diego Harbor, and nobody knew he was there. So that got people's attention. They didn't hurt anybody, but they made their presence known. Now, the American public won't know that, and the only reason I know it is because of what I did for 30 years. So the American people have no clue that the Chinese basically told the Americans to back off, quit putting nuclear carriers in our backyard. So if they wanted to hurt us, that was the perfect opportunity for them to do it. They're not like that. They don't want a war. They want a level playing field that we can get along with. Everybody plays, everybody gets along. We don't have to have weapons, we don't have to have wars. And that's where they're going with this. And it's hard for the Western civilizations to understand it.
Of course, it's hard for us to understand it, at least from my personal opinion, is because we've had our heads in the sand, because we've been fed a line of goods from our parents and grandparents, and, you know, and we believe, and I'm not saying it's all false, but, you know, there's certain falsehoods, there's certain marketing. I can only imagine how conniving things have been. And I'm not saying our government, everybody is piece of crap. I mean, believe me, there's good and bad in everything, whether it's the CIA, the FBI, you know, any number. I mean, we are American citizens. We are a proud nation. But yeah, I can definitely see how that's true. And I guess the reason that I asked you to be on this call, and the reason that I've been preaching so much here in the past few weeks, is because I don't want people, even if outrageous as some of the things that you've said tonight, and some people are probably pissed off after this call. They'll probably want, you know, my head on a platter, or, you know, Terry Kays or any number of different people. Yes, Terry, I did say your name. But I guess the truth needs to come out. Now, some people may yell back as when I say that that's not the truth. But at the same time, I guess when this all finally goes down, we'll see the real proof in the pudding. You know, it's like it's all going to come out sooner or later. So I guess we'll all just have to wait. But as I've told other people on the calls, as preposterous as it sounds for us to all get rich off and jump up 3,000-4,000%, you know, open your minds enough to be able to listen to this gentleman, to hear what he has to say. You know, you can't make up this stuff. You can't suddenly, you know, be able to just pinpoint all these different things that you've said. And I guarantee you probably haven't even hit on hardly anything compared to what you could get into. And I'm not going to ask you to do that. But I guess what I have to say, because I know you have to go. I mean, we've been an hour and a half into this conversation, and I know people would love to hear more. But I guess if you had, you know, one last thing to tell everybody, you know, not just with the Iraqi dinar or the global settlements or prosperity programs and so forth and so on, but what would you tell people? I mean, going forth with everything you've had to say, with all this being so hard to swallow, what would you tell them?
Well, I would tell them that God gave them a brain, and it's time they have to step up the plate and use it. I would tell them to be prudent. I would not do anything quickly. I would watch things settle out. Once this gets underway, which I expect in the next day or so, it's going to be very, very quick. I wouldn't make any major decisions for at least 6 months to a year and watch the dust settle. And then you'll see the proof of my words. Either they'll be true or they won't, and only you can make that judgment. My entire life, I have unwittingly been thrust into this, not by design, but just by where I was and what I did. And it was very hard for me to grasp onto this. The area that I was in tech, and it was populated with more PhDs than you'll find on any college campus. And the stuff we worked with was very high. Now, I tell you that because what I'm telling you tonight is, I know it's like trying to get a drink of water from a fire hose. There's a lot there coming at you right now. And I have a lot of empathy for you, and I understand that. And this is not something to be afraid of or to get upset with. This is not an emotional thing. This is just the way history unfolded. But you have to take your time now, and you have to understand that you've been led astray all of your life. And now you're going to have that moment in the Dachau concentration camp. You're going to have to walk through and see the truth, and it isn't going to be pretty. But for your own sanity, take your time, what you do, and let the information evolve. You've got kind of a very, very shallow scratch of the surface tonight. But there's going to be a lot more things come out, a lot of things I probably don't even know about. But the fact is there's been a huge, huge operation that's going on right before your very eyes. And when it's unveiled to you, you're going to have this aha moment and realize that all these things have been hidden in plain sight. And it's going to be a shock. And so that's why I keep referring to this as your dock out moment. Because it's going to be hard to swallow, and it isn't going to be easy for any American to realize what's really been going on. So the best advice I can give to you is all of you have a common interest, and stick together and do research, and don't take anything at face value, and take your time in the decisions you make, because the world is changing now, and it's changing in a very dynamic way that we have never seen in the history of mankind before. This is a monumental moment. And that's why all this is probably so hard to swallow, is because the deception has been monumental for the last 100 years. And now this charade is being disrobed. And what you're going to see is going to shock you. And what I'm telling you is nowhere near what you're going to discover. But this is not the moment in your life to be afraid. This is the moment in your life to pay attention. This is the moment in your life where you have to be deliberate and prudent about what you do.
You know, it reminds me of a buddy of mine who I get a little bit of intel from on all this Dinar stuff. But he pointed out the Matrix movie. And there comes that point where, do I take the red pill and see what's behind the veil here, the curtain, or do I take the blue pill and go back to my life? And I guess that's where I'm at with all of this, you know. And God, for some reason, put me in touch with you and Thing One and Thing Two, the people that you know, at least to a certain degree. And, you know, because I wanted to know the truth, and I spoke about this last night on our conference call, and I really did. I wanted to know the truth. I mean, that's what everybody seeks, is truth, right? You want to hear it out of people's mouths. You want to be able to see it. You want to be able to touch it to some degree. And I guess, again, that's why I brought you onto this call. And before I let you go, I do have one other question, is with these prosperity programs, the global settlement, a lot of people don't believe them. They don't believe them. I mean, even the people who have said they're going to get these prosperity programs, people who said they're going to get these settlements, whether it's CMKX or people who have been told that they're getting money from donors to any number of different things. What can you tell people who are listening, who are in this, you know, in that realm, I guess you'd say, is there anything that you could tell them to give them some sort of hope or indication or anything of it's coming to an end? Because I know that we've discussed this. You mentioned it about, hey, we're in the final hours. But, of course, we've all heard that before. It's like chasing our tail to a certain certain extreme. So if you could hit on that, that would be great.
Okay, well, the whole thing has been designed to chase your tail. That's the irony of this. The prosperity programs were actually Ponzi schemes designed to engage in illegal transactions and drug laundering. And all those things were done as part of sanctioned government activity, albeit with the CIA. And so each time one was created, another one would be created as a counter to it to gut it. And so the idea, it was a Ponzi scheme designed to gut a Ponzi scheme, designed to gut another Ponzi scheme, and they kept building money. And at some point, they decided in order to stop this, they would throw the money out. Let me give you the only example I can think of that would be appropriate. Let's say in your neighborhood, you have a guy that is selling drugs. And this guy is the bane of the neighborhood. He terrorizes everybody. But you know up in his bedroom, he's got millions and millions of dollars in cash. So one day you decide the way to stop him is you run up there and you take the cash and you run, but you don't keep it for yourself. You throw it all over the street so all the people get it. Now it's impossible for him to regain that money to start all over again. And so that's what this is all about, is taking the money and throwing it out to everybody so it cannot be given back, so it cannot be retrieved, so that the only way they're going to have to play fairly or die.
Yeah, but how does it, well, and again, it's probably getting back into another bigger questions, but it just seems like, you know, we hear about like CMKX, huge Ponzi scheme, right?
Yeah.
And how do they hold on to that money? And I even, you know, talking with some of your contacts, you know, of how they use that money. You know, and how
it was a series of shell corporations and trusts, and all this money moved around, one scheme trying to out-scheme the other one. But all these accounts were used for illegal trading and used for money laundering and used for drugs, and they had a mechanical purpose in the black world a long time ago. But in order to stop it, in order to basically purge the money out so that it couldn't be reconstituted to continue this nonsense, is they put names to these scams, and then they created an avenue to vent the money out to people like you and me. And once it's out, that's the reason they're fighting this, because once it's out, they can't reconstitute the money anymore, because it's divided up amongst thousands of people. Now it's impossible for them to regain their power.
And there's how many, if you know, but how many different prosperity programs are there approximately, or how many different global settlements? I mean, CMKX is considered the biggest in history, but how many of these are there? Are there factual evidence? I mean, I know that I have the documentation, the court documentation, for CMKX, but are there others out there that people can go and research and see, hey, here's another one, here's another one? I mean, we heard about Citibank paying off a massive global settlement here just, I think it was a couple weeks ago. So
yeah.
Are there others out there that people can actually say, hey, you know, this stuff is real?
Well, I know the stuff I research is real, and it probably isn't germane to everybody here, but the point of this is that they weren't designed to be found. They were designed as Ponzi schemes, and so the very paper they were written on was designed to vaporize. It was never designed to come out of the dark world and to see the light of day. And you had two factions within the CIA. You had the faction that understood what Casey was talking about, to undermine the nations that were threats monetarily, and then to recoup that money and put it back into the tree. And then you have the other side that decided to hijack that money and use it for all kinds of nefarious activities, like propping up dictators and running drugs and laundering drug money and providing weapons to every despot in the world. And there's so many parts to this, so many spider holes, it's just hard to wrap your mind around it because it was so huge. If I told you that I saw wire transfers to the Pilgrim Fund, which is the slush fund for the Bushes, that were routinely $500 and $600 billion each, and I got dozens of copies of these wire transfers, that's hard to wrap your mind around, because you can't imagine how huge this is. So when you take all that money and you disperse it to the common person, that it cannot be reconstituted again, these people lose their power. That's what this is all about, because they hijacked an idea that was designed to bring global peace, and they use it for their self-enrichment. And so those are the two factions going on here. And the Chinese understand that, hey, you know what, we need to kick in and help this get done so that we will have world peace, so that we can actually, you know, have a world without huge militaries that are always on edge and 18 minutes from destruction. You know what I mean? We have to think a different way. And we can't look at everybody on this planet as a threat. And so Yeah, I think I told you before, Rodney, when before I shipped overseas to Southeast Asia, they run you through POW camp, and you've got 15 guys running a POW camp of 400 guys. And what they would do is they'd divide us up, black from white, Hispanic from Asian, officer from enlisted, blonde hair from brown hair, and then they give certain people privileges and certain people they torture. And they did this to show how they control a population by making one part of the population look privileged and the other part of the population to be trampled on. And then within our own prison population, we started fighting amongst each other, and that's how they controlled us. Well, that's what's happened to our entire society. We're divided up, conservative from liberal, Republican from Democrat, woman from man, black from white. I don't care. You can find more divisions in our society than you can count. But the fact of the matter is, everybody listening to my voice right now, if you cut your finger, I guarantee you all of us bleed red blood. And so that unification is what they never, ever want to bring up. But the Chinese understand that we are all one. And this is hard for Westerners to wrap their mind around. And as we're all one, we can regain power of our country. We can regain power of our world, and that's what this is all about, a transparency that keeps them from ever reconstituting their wealth again to do these things. But we have to get a new education. We have to see things as they are and not as we've been told they are.
Yeah, because I'm assuming they already have a game plan ready to go after this thing goes down.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. And I guess that's where my concern is that, and, you know, even talking to my father about this, I'm like, why did I get myself into this? You know, God, what's your plan here? But it just comes down to even Terry and I, you know, and Funny Steve, when we created this website with all these NR people, you know, basically listening to us, it was like making certain that we don't create the same mistakes over and over again. And I guess that's my concern here. And even as many people call me crazy for having this call with you to other calls, and it's blasphemy, it's any number of different things, you're out of your mind. I don't think so. I really, you know, again, you can't make stuff up like this. You know, if you start to take your emotions out of it and you start looking at it objectively and analyzing it and so forth, you're going to see it. You know, it's just like my father had me read this book one time. It was called Illusions. Of course, I've read it a couple different times. But, you know, it was amazing, you know, in this. It's like taking yourself out of the equation, sitting back in the audience and looking and really seeing what's going on, which means taking the emotion out of it. You can really see things for what they truly are. But it's hard for us to do that. I mean, everything that I see going on just here in the United States, it's all emotion-driven. You know, like you said, I mean, you made the perfect, it's like, they don't make you watch television, whether it's a film or anything nowadays, they don't have any segment cut more than, I think it's 7 or 9 seconds. And why is that? Because our attention span, you know, can't hang that long, you know?
That's
like,
right,
well,
yeah, that's right.
So cool.
Yeah,
but,
yeah, that's right.
Anyhow,
yeah, I mean, it's gonna be an education, but we're all in this together. But the biggest thing I want to impart is that things are not as they appear to have been, and there's evidence all around you if you just look. And
right.
if you doubt this, go outside and look at the heavens. The universe is infinitely abundant, but to have shortages and to have not enough money, not enough food, not enough water, those are created by man. We live in a universe that's infinitely abundant, and yet we have shortages of everything, medical attention, food, money. That's because it's all about controlling people. Our natural state is abundance, and you have to get beyond seeing the way the world has been for the last 200 years and understand how it had always been before this all started. We live in an infinitely abundant universe, and we deny that truth every day when we buy into these charades of wars and famine and economic. economic downturns and depression, and this is all through the robber barons down through history controlling the workers of this world, controlling the middle class, controlling the population in mass. And until you understand that, until you come to grips with that truth, that's not an opinion, not the truth. You can look at and see the abundance of the universe right now. Go outside of heaven. There are more stars up there than you can count. And if you take a head of a pin and hold it up the sky, behind that head of that pin are at least four or five other galaxies with millions of stars in them. You just can't see them. Now that's how abundant our universe is, and yet we live on this little blue marble, and we have shortages after shortages that we create. And we just can't see that that's being done by men to manipulate other men. That's the truth that's in front of us, and yet we deny it every day.
Yeah. Well, sir, I can't thank you enough for coming out to this call.